you're going to hear a lot more about the green economy, and you're going to think that that sounds good, and that's probably something that we should be striving toward, but the way it is being put together by the corporate and political and business and academic elite of our world, it is not at all a good thing. The green economy is, in their language, in their terms, is based on, are based on false solutions that the market will fix everything, and the only way to protect nature is to bring all of nature into the market economy, put a dollar figure on it, and then let it compete for its own survival. The crudest way I ever heard it put was by Mugabe, who said the wildlife in our country will have to pay for themselves. In other words, they'll hunt or be photographed or whatever, or they won't survive. If they can't pay for themselves, they don't survive. That is an honest assessment of where we're going. So you get carbon markets, of course, which is the trading of pollution. And when you talk about can't privatize the air, that is privatizing the air. And it's really all about carbon emissions, carbon trading, to make a small group wealthy and to allow us to continue business as usual. We're now into water trading. You're going to hear a lot more about this in the near future. Water trading is where a country or a community converts the water licenses to actual property rights, and then says, well, go and trade them, and you'll, because you can make money by conserving, that will probably happen. Australia was one of the first countries in the world to do this. In 1993, the government, conservative government, converted all the licenses, mostly held by great big agribusiness, like huge cotton producers, rice producers, water producers, who are taking that water of the Murray Darling River, using it to grow commodities, and then exporting it out of the country. And the Murray Darling was dying. So they said, well, we'll convert it to a market economy, and that will protect it, because then water will be worth something. Immediately, the price started to rise. The big companies started buying out the small companies, the big farmers, the big agribusinesses bought out the rest of the small ones. And then the big industrial investors came in, and even foreign investors. Flip forward, when the Labour government tried to buy back that water for the Murray Darling to save it, they couldn't afford it. The price of water had gone up from $2 a gigalitre to $2,400 in one decade. Alberta is now openly talking about water markets, so it's not going to happen in this country, and British Columbia has started the discussion. Just little papers, you know how they drop these things out? They just drop them from these academic institutions or the Fraser Institute, and they just drip them into the air, and then you just know that the powers that be are moving in this direction. But Alberta is openly going to water markets, and Alberta is going to be the first water have-not province in our country. I mean, they don't have the water to be trading or anything else. And then we have this PES, Payment for Environmental Services, or Payment for Ecological Services. It's used both ways. And this is a huge project of the United Nations, and the United Nations Environment Program has actually just completed a study where they have put a dollar figure on nature. And you'll be happy to know that they say nature is worth $72 trillion. How they got there, I don't know. But now we know nature is worth $72 trillion. So somehow we have to come up with a way to find the money to save nature that's going to compete with other uses of that nature that would be bringing in more money than $72 trillion. It's a very, very, very dangerous game. But I'm hearing it in law schools. I'm hearing students in environmental classes talking about it. It's certainly being taught in business classes. You're going to hear a lot more about this. The only way to save nature is to bring it into the market economy and make it part of the future as it stands now. A perfect example of the human-centered folly of this way of thinking. Last week I heard commentator talking about the situation in Japan with the nuclear reactor, and he said, well, don't worry, by the time the radioactive spill gets into the fish that humans eat, it will be so dispersed it won't hurt humans. So it's okay. And this is what's wrong with our way of thinking. The notion of the rights of nature shifts the balance in a very important way. Yes, of course, we're still going to promote human development and community development, but in a way that protects nature and promotes sustainability. And this will be written into law. And I mean, one day, this will be written into law. Think about this. What if the Gulf could sue BP? What if the ocean around Japan could sue the private nuclear facility, the owners of the nuclear facility there? What if the Athabasca River could sue everybody? What if Lake Winnipeg could sue for the nitrates that we dump into it every day? This is not as far-fetched as you might think. Ecuador and now Bolivia are the first two countries in the world to actually introduce and adopt rights of nature language, and it's really strong language. But a number of other countries are beginning to take similar kinds of moves. India has named its water and its rivers as akin, having human rights, having rights akin to human rights to be protected. So the notion is that they have rights outside of their use to humans. I'm working with people in the United States who are bringing in ordinances in many communities. I'd love for us to start thinking about this here. This is where communities are not willing to wait anymore for their governments to protect these resources, and they're actually taking action themselves. Communities in Maine are saying, you know, we don't want the bottled water industry in here, and they pass ordinances saying you're not welcome here, and they're actually keeping them out. There's a community in Pennsylvania where they were due to put a huge sludge garbage dump on a piece of wild land, or as one forestry guy calls it, decadent wilderness, which is my favorite term, decadent wilderness, just sitting there being decadent and unused. So they're going to throw this sludge on it, and they passed an ordinance. Actually, they named this particular area a legal person in the eyes of the law, and they have so far protected it from this kind of sludge. The question is, what is nature? Is nature an object? Is nature a resource? Or is it a living system, a community, in fact, based on laws that govern and sustain it? If it's the latter, and I see that you can see that I think it is, then our laws, our human laws, have to become compatible with the nature, the laws of nature. When Fox News jokingly says, oh, does every insect have the same right as humans? No. But does a species have a right not to be extinct, to be made extinct? You're darn right. Does a watershed have a right to exist and not be destroyed? Absolutely. And we dream of the day when we actually can protect this in some form of very serious law. I give you the words of a wonderful net man whose name is Cormac Cullinan, and he's written an extremely important book called Wild Law, A Manifesto for the Earth. He's an environmental and human rights lawyer in South Africa. He says, the day will come when the failure of our laws to recognize the right of a river to flow, to prohibit acts that destabilize the Earth's climate, or to impose a duty to respect the intrinsic value and right to exist of all life will be as reprehensible as allowing people to be bought and sold. We will only flourish by changing these systems and claiming our identity, as well as assuming our responsibility as members of the Earth community. So what we're talking about here then is what it would look like if we governed this Earth with what Vandana Shiva calls the notion of Earth democracy, by seeing nature then as a commons and that has rights and is guided by the notion that all people and all other species have rights to this, to be shared more equitably by all of us who live on it and derive our livelihood and life from it. And it could not be hoarded and abused by those with power. And many of us now are talking about re-energizing the whole notion of the commons, which was a very old notion and a very old form of law, which said that nobody should be denied the right to grazing or fishing or hunting or, you know, their livelihood, even if that land was owned by nobility. And the first enclosure of the commons in Western society was the laws of 1740 that removed the peasants from the land in Great Britain. And you may have heard the old poem or the old nursery rhyme about they hang the man and flog the woman, that steal the goose from off the common, but let the greater villain loose that steals the common from the goose. It's got a nice ending, though, because it says, they hang the man and flog the woman who steals the goose from off the common, and geese will steal a common lack until they go and steal it back. So there's we are taking back the commons, and this is what we're talking about. So if we are to be governed, if we are to see the nature as part of a global commons, then we need to protect it with public trust law, and that sets the perimeters for protecting and sharing this well and carefully managed commons for the benefit of all, not just for those who have privilege and money. So, give you a very real example here, in juxtaposition to water markets, the state of Vermont had no legislation protecting its groundwater, and they had a lot of companies coming in and pumping away, destroying local water tables. So a few years ago, and I worked with them on this, they adopted unanimously a law that said that their groundwater is a public trust and it belongs to all Vermonters. And even if you own property on that, you may use it, but you don't own it. It doesn't belong to you, and you can't destroy it, and you can't overuse it. And in fact, if you're going to use more than a certain amount per day, you need to get a license. And they actually name that in times of shortage, the access will get, priority access will be given to water for drinking water and for regular life, for sustainable local food production rather than export production, and for ecosystem protection. So we're actually beginning to get this the wording of this notion in legislation in different places. So let's come back to Manitoba and think about some examples here, and if we were to apply this notion of the rights of nature and nature as a commons, and people's equitable access to that commons, which is a different kind of sharing. It doesn't mean everybody gets to a free-for-all, it means a different kind of sharing. What might it look like here? Well, and in Canada generally. I just picked a few issues and items here, but one is was already mentioned, and that's the tragic situation of First Nations communities here in Manitoba and around the country in terms of drinking water and sanitation. It simply would not be tolerated that First Nations, First Peoples, would not have first right, if you will, to the waters that they had no part of polluting, no part of destroying. Another would be Bucko Lake. I don't know if people here know, but there is a lake that has been given the go-ahead to be one of the Schedule 2 lakes here in Manitoba. It's up in Wabauten, and it's going to destroy not only that lake, but the fishing ground and the hunting area for the local First Nations people. Now this is, Schedule 2 is an amendment to the Fisheries Act. The Fisheries Act says nobody can put anything deleterious to aquatic life into a fish-bearing lake or river, but you can, as a mining company, you can apply to the government to have that lake renamed a tailings impoundment area, and then it's no longer subject to the Fisheries Act. So we're taking this act to court because we're working with people in Newfoundland who are trying to stop the destruction it's a lake, they call it a pond, but it's sandy pond, but it's a huge lake, which is slated for destruction this summer. We did manage to work with First Nations people to save Fish Lake in British Columbia. For the time being, the company's come back, the company's called Taseko. But this is a very important test case because we have at least a dozen lakes across the country that are exempted from the Fisheries Act, which wasn't very well managed anyway. Or the whole debate around Veolia and the wastewater services here, and I do want to say as strongly as I can that the fight back here has resulted in a partial win. We don't want Veolia here at all, but certainly now it's, I think that we can say that some of the worst aspects of the original deal have been dealt with, and it will now be publicly run, owned, and financed, and I give total and complete credit to those who fought this here and people across the country. But if you had this notion that your human laws have to be compatible with the laws of nature, you would never consider privatizing water or privatizing an essential public service. Because no matter, even if they're the most honest and honorable companies on earth, and let me tell you, Veolia is not, but even if they were, they cannot make money by doing the very thing we have to do, and that's conserving. They have to sell more. I mean, it's the principle of the marketplace. That's the dead hand of the market. They cannot make money by conserving, and that's exactly what we have to do if we're not going to hit that 40%+ mark that this study talked about. Gas fracking, we've got 300 wells in exploration in Manitoba alone. And if we had this notion of the rights of nature, the rights of water, we could not destroy water to find a so-called softer solution to energy sources. Commercial water exports, I know that under this government this will not happen, but believe me, there are business interests that have their eye on Manitoba's water. Very specifically, there are some interests to export it for commercial purpose to Texas. Again, you would never be able to consider selling water if in a time of crisis. Do you share? Let's talk about it. But you would not conceivably consider selling water, and it never would go to those who need it most, but it would go to Las Vegas and Arizona and all the places that are using it, continuing to use it so poorly. Do you know the largest water theme park in the world is being built as we speak in Arizona, just as an example. Land grabs, I haven't heard of any here yet in Manitoba, but there are investment and hedge fund people knocking on farm doors in Saskatchewan and saying, would you like to retire? We'll give you lots of money for this. They're just buying up the land and holding it for future time, the land and the water. This is so prevalent in Africa now. There is now an area twice the size of Great Britain that has been bought by private interests, holding it for future time. This is a huge geopolitical shift, and worse than any form of colonialism that has gone before it. It's really a very dangerous thing. You could never conceive of having these kind of land grabs if nature had these kind of rights. And finally, the right of corporations to sue governments for protecting resources or protecting social services or whatever for their people. We have a very bad precedent. A company named Abitibi Bowater, a big pulp and paper company, was operating in Newfoundland. 3 years ago, they left Newfoundland voluntarily, left all the jobs behind, and turned around and said, now you owe us money for the water and timber rights we left behind. And then Premier Danny Williams told them where they could put that. And yes, but the Harper government turned around, and without even going to an AFTA panel, without even fighting for Newfoundland's rights or the rights of water or the rights of the local people to this water, they gave them $125 million in settlement and set a precedent in this country and actually in all the trade dealings around the world that these corporations can now consider the water they need to use, whether they're growing food or producing oil or mining or whatever it is that they're doing, they can use that water. And they actually can claim now to own that water. And if you try to make them clean it up or use less or whatever, they can turn around and sue you financially. Now we're going to add all the European companies to this as well. How would this vision save Lake Winnipeg? By naming Lake Winnipeg a commons and a public trust and a protected bioregion with its own rights. Lake Winnipeg itself would have the right not to be poisoned by the behavior of the humans around it. And if we had this kind of law, you would not, as you have now, have to prove that you have been directly affected by it. You wouldn't have to prove that you have property on Lake Winnipeg so that you can show that you have been personally damaged. The right would belong to the lake. The right would belong, but the right would be intrinsic to the water itself, to the species that live in it, to the plants that surround it and live in it as well. I have a colleague who has a lovely phrase. She talks about the right not to know, what it's like when you have privilege and you just simply don't have to know all this stuff. You can go through life without it. And I thought, well, what's the corollary to the right not to know? Is it the right to know? I think it's probably more like the right to care. And I think we have to instill in ourselves and in our children the right to care. I don't have to be a scientist and have every detail about what's happening to Lake Winnipeg. I don't have to be the head of an environmental group. I don't have to be a teacher somewhere. I can be just the most ordinary person in the sense of what I may know technically, I can see with my eyes, I can sense with my heart that something is deeply wrong, and I have the right to know, and we will come together to protect this. I've just finished a paper on the Great Lakes calling it a people's plan to protect the Great Lakes forever. And I, based on this kind of model, and I use as an example, there's a nuclear reactor called Bruce Power, a private nuclear company, on Georgian Bay on Lake Huron, and they are planning, and they've got the go-ahead from the Harper government to send 16 bus-size spent nuclear reactors, the size of school buses, by ship to go to Sweden to be recycled, so-called, down Lake Huron, up through Erie, up through Ontario, up the St. Lawrence and across the ocean. And we're not going to get our governments to say no. We've had some concern from some of them, but basically nobody's saying anything. The community around the Great Lakes is coming together, particularly First Nations. And I have the image from, you know, Lord of the Rings with Gandalf saying, "You shall not pass." They're not going to be allowed to pass certain points because the people aren't going to let them. But this is becoming a rallying cry for those of us around the lakes who say, they're not yours. You simply cannot take that chance with them. Congratulations to the government here for supporting this wonderful initiative on the heritage site, the UNESCO World Heritage Site. This is fabulous, and I was deeply moved, I think, for anybody from outside of Manitoba who hasn't seen these images. It's incredibly important, and we need to tell the story outside of this province. And congratulations, obviously, on the hydro-bipole decision, and may it be a huge election issue. And we're just hoping that the government is going to be as good on another issue as they're being on that one, and that is to revoke the recent license to allow increased emissions, pollution emissions, some of them carcinogens, at the Louisiana Pacific operation in Swan Valley, at a Swan Valley plant. Those were hard-won gains that we got years ago, and we need them back, and we need the government here to really take this issue on. So I'm just going to stop in a second and we'll chat. I just want to tell you one last nice story, and I want to leave you with some hope, because I think there is lots of hope. I've come away from this week at the United Nations with enormous hope. I was very, very moved by the comments of a number of the countries, and not just developing countries, some of the so-called developed countries. Spain got up and made a wonderful, wonderful statement about the rights of nature. Our country, of course, didn't speak. The United States said they didn't understand anything that had been said. As Elizabeth May says, it's a great, great quote, she says, "Obama may not be George Bush, but the United States is still the United States." But I am hopeful, because I think that every now and then the human species takes an evolutionary step forward. And I swear to you, I believe with my heart that this notion of the rights of nature, the rights of Mother Earth, the rights of Pachamama, is a step forward for us evolutionarily. And it is going to be a huge fight. But you know, it was a huge fight when they got that 1948 Declaration on Human Rights. That was a huge fight. And Eleanor Roosevelt was vilified and mocked, and cruel cartoons were drawn about her and her looks and so on. It was a noble and wonderful fight, and now it's accepted universally, and of course it doesn't always work, and of course there are still, I debated somebody the other day, said, well, there's still a human rights violation, so it was useless. It's useless to have a dream as a human species that we can be better than we've been in the past, and that we can end these kind of horrors to each other. Is it a useless dream to think that maybe nature could be a gift to us if we can see it this way? Like water could be one of nature's gifts to teach us how to stop fighting with each other. My favorite group in this example here is the Friends of the Earth Middle East, who said, you know, and these are people from all the warring communities, Israel, Palestine, Lebanon, so on. And they come together and they say, we don't talk religion, we don't talk politics, we don't talk history, we just talk about how to save the Jordan River. And they've actually worked so hard together that they've actually taken down a piece of the wall, which I think is very moving in one of the very war-torn areas. And one of my favorite photos is nine mayors from 9 different towns and villages around the Jordan, from warring factions, all holding hands and jumping in the Jordan River to show how together they have something in common. I mean, it's like the Comet movies, that the comet's coming at you, and you know, you only have 72 hours to live as the whole world will be blown up, and suddenly all those differences don't mean very much. Well, we have some very serious issues here, and if we can come together around this notion, I think it could be an enormously binding event for us. And miracles do happen. So my last little story to you is a miracle. We've been fighting for the right to water, the human right to water, for years. It was not included in the 1948 Universal Declaration because at the time no one could see that it was a problem. But for at least 2 decades now, we have known it's a huge problem. In the global south, every 3.5 seconds, a child dies of waterborne disease. Every 3.5 seconds. It is the greatest killer of children, more than HIV, AIDS, malaria, more than accidents put together. And in every single case, if the parents had money, those kids wouldn't be dying. Talk about privatization of an essential resource. And so we've been fighting, and we've been getting nowhere. And the country that's led the fight against the right to water has been Canada, under the Liberals before us, and now quite strongly under the Harper government. And we just thought there's years more study, that's what I thought is going to be enough. If you'd asked me a year ago, I'd have said 10 to 15 years before we get it. Bolivia, this brilliant little landlocked country, has an ambassador named Pablo Solon to the UN. He decided last June that he was just sick of waiting. His kids are dying, not his, but the kids in his country are dying from lack of water, and he just decided he'd had it, and he wanted to know which countries would have the guts to say yes or no. So he put a resolution to the General Assembly, and everybody freaked, you can't do that, that recognition that drinking water and sanitation, included sanitation, is a fundamental human right. And all the countries, a lot of them, US and Canada, Great Britain and Australia, got together and tried to derail it and didn't. And it came to a vote on July 28th, and I was in the General Assembly when the vote took place with some of my staff. And we sat up on the balcony, and when the UN votes, they vote from their chairs, and it comes up on a big electronic board. So I held the hands of my staff, and I said, we're not going to win this, and it's okay, because we got this far, and the language is brilliant, and it's wonderful, and don't worry, we'll be back here in a few years, and this time, or one of these times, we'll get it, blah, blah, blah. Right? They start to vote, 122 countries vote in favor, not one votes against, and 41, including Canada, abstain. So we overwhelmingly won this incredible vote. And 2 months later, the Human Rights Council adopted a similar resolution laying out the obligations to governments, and because this one was based on 2 binding treaties, it rendered the first one binding as well. And I've just finished a paper which should be up on our website and hopefully at the longest in 2 weeks, basically telling what this means and what we should be doing with it here in Canada and around the world. But we had our first test case, and that's what I want to finish with this test case, and it was the Kalahari Bushmen of Botswana. Government of Botswana has a neoliberal, horrible president who he has openly said he hates the Kalahari Bushmen. They live in the Kalahari Desert, it's a game reserve. They live the way their ancestors did, in loincloths and spears. He says they're an embarrassing anachronism. He wears Brioni suits and gorgeous Italian watches and stuff, and he's embarrassed by them. Also, they found diamonds in the Kalahari, and they want the water resources for De Beers diamonds. Plus, they want to put up a big set of eco lodges, which he's invested in. So they started herding them off and putting them into reserves off the Kalahari. And the people kept coming back because this is their way of life. They were getting sick, they were dying off the reserve. As they came back, the government said, well, we'll make it so you can't, and they smashed their water hole. They had one important major borehole. They smashed it and they said, we will kill anybody trying to rebuild that water hole. And it's been a terrible case. Survival International has worked with them. In 2006, they won a partial victory. They won the right to go back to the desert, but they did not win the right to water. So they appealed, and the week before the United Nations General Assembly resolution on the right to water was adopted, they lost that case. However, based on the two right to water resolutions of the UN, they appealed again to the Supreme Court. And several months ago, on January 27th, they unanimously won the right not only to go back to their land, not only to have their water borehole reopened, but to open more and to be restituted for the suffering that they have endured. And it was a very, very important first step for us. And I can remember just back to July 28th when, after the vote, all these countries, including Canada, got up and just berated the Bolivian government and, you know, kind of yelled at Pablo Solon saying, you know, we weren't ready for this and how could you push this on the world and you, this was undemocratic. And he stood there with this shit-eating grin, this to say, at what part of I won do you not understand? And we really did win. And we're hoping to be able to use these resolutions to work with First Nations communities in Canada to ensure their human right to water. I tell you this because I think it's very important that we have hope and that we see that the march for Western civilization, or I was going to say civilization, I remember that somebody said to Gandhi, what do you think of Western civilization? He said it would be a good idea. Yeah. The desire to move ourselves forward as a human species is hard, and we seem to take one step forward and another step back and sometimes two steps back, but there is hope. And I want, on this beautiful Mother Earth Day, I want to leave you with this hope, and I want to leave you with my favorite quote from Tolkien. And this is Gandalf talking about being a steward on this terrible night when all beauty and all nature may die. And he says this, and I'm sharing it with you because I'm assuming if you're out here on a Friday night that you're stewards as well. He says, the rule of no realm is mine, but all worthy things that are in peril as the world now stands, those are my care. And for my part, I shall not wholly fail in my task if anything passes through this night that can still grow fair or bear fruit and flower again in the days to come. For I too am a steward. Did you not know? Thank you so much.